Please take your seats. Good morning. It's great to see you here this morning. Thanks for joining us in Dale St. Andrews. If you are visiting, and I know we have a few visitors this morning, some here to support the ladies in our guild who are to receive certificates, others for other reasons, you are very welcome indeed. We hope you can join us in the hall after the service for a cup of tea or coffee. And if you don't know where that is, then follow the smell of the coffee. No. Go through this door, right to the end of the corridor, or if you have to insist on shaking my hand, through the front door and down and round the side of the building. This is a wee bit of an unusual service because we're going to be singing twice as many hymns this morning as we normally do, but we'll be the better for that, I'm sure, especially because there's nae sermon. That was the right reaction, by the way. I have to say I was expecting a round of applause, but the awe was the right reaction. We're not quite at panto season yet, but we're nearly there. Anyway, so yes, each of the hymns this morning has been chosen by the ladies who are to receive their long service certificates. And there's a wee bit of a story behind many of them, so listen up for that as we go along. But before that, just a few items of news. First of all, it's great to welcome back Charles Wiley, who is our BSL signer this morning. Charles has not been with us for a wee while. His dad has been unwell, and so we ask you to convey to him that we'll be remembering him in our prayers, Charles. And it's great to see you, especially because Paula Maguire, who was to be our note taker this morning, can't be here now. Sadly, Paula's mother-in-law, her husband Jerry's mum, died during the night, last night. So our thoughts and our prayers are with Paula and Jerry and with their family at this very difficult time, very raw time for them. There's quite a lot of things restarted in the church, as you'll see from our news sheet. There's a huge amount of things going on. This afternoon is Messy Church. And then during this week, it's quite busy. Tuesday is our elders' meeting. Thursday, Friday, Saturday is Keswick and Motherwell. If you've not been to that, then each evening at 7:30, it's brilliant music from Heath Robinson, who become great friends of mine and my wife's, and also some super preaching from Steve Brady. And it's here in our sanctuary, so familiar to you, and if you can come for one or more evenings, you really will thoroughly enjoy that, and it's free as well, although an offering is always taken if you wish to give to that. And then next weekend, we've got our harvest service for all age, and these envelopes for Tear Fund are available this morning. If you want to take one of these away with you, put something in it, bring it back next Sunday, then the money will be sent for the work of Tear Fund among some of the world's poorest people. In the afternoon next Sunday, there's a special event, the Scottish Deaf Choirs Festival. It's going to take place here at 2:00. And this sounds like it'll be an amazing time. So if you're free and you're able to come, again, you'd be made very, very welcome to that. And then the following week, it's actually not Saturday the 20th of September, just a wee correction there. It's Thursday the 20th of September. There's a special brass concert in Motherwell Salvation Army Citadel. And again, that's free. You'd be welcome to go along to that. I think that'll be a tremendous time for those who are able to attend. And then just probably two further things to highlight, sorry. I've not been well the last few days. Hey, you're getting really good at this. Yeah. No, I was poorer than that. That's better. This is getting more like Francie and Josie every week, doesn't it? It really does. So I'm a wee bit kind of forgetting things. So a wee bit more than normal even. Who said that's age? Susan, I nearly said Refford there. Susan Boland. You're welcome. It'll come to you as well. The newsletter, the next edition of Kirk Matters is now available. So those who deliver them, or if you pick up your own, then they're through in the hall. And final thing, yes, George Martin, our caretaker, is retiring in the next couple of weeks. So we're looking for a replacement. If you know anyone who may be interested and wants further details, then if they can actually either speak to Helen Lawson or to Alec Baird, then we would be very grateful. My goodness, that was longer than I thought it'd be. Right, here we go. We're here to worship God together. Happy to see that our first hymn has been chosen by our eldest member. Sorry, Chris. You're also known as one of our most gracious and kind members, not just our eldest. And it's Almighty Father of all things that be. Now, when I asked Chris for a favorite hymn, she immediately chose this one, particularly for verse 4. Thou dost the strength to worker's arm impart, from thee the skilled musician's mystic art, the grace of poet's pen or painter's hand to teach the loveliness of sea and land. And she chose that in particular, she told me, because, of course, her husband, Jimmy, was a painter. And if you want to see some of his work, then there are two paintings within the building, one out here and another one out here, of the old DL North building, what's now the Glow Centre. And Jimmy Olsen did both of those paintings. Beautiful they are. And so that mention of the painter's hand, a gift given by God, was what inspired Chris to choose this lovely hymn to kick off our worship this morning.
Thank you.
beautiful start to our praise service. Should have said earlier also that the children are going to stay in Sunday school and have a great time there this morning while we're having a super time singing God's praise. The second of our praise items this morning is a paraphrase of the well-known Psalm 23, a piece of scripture which has given generations of people comfort at difficult times in their lives, not least time of bereavement. For my choice, it's probably one of the top three best versions of the 23rd Psalm. It's been chosen on this occasion by Eleanor Weir, and it just happens to be the first of two versions of Psalm 23 that we're actually going to sing this morning. Can I say just before we sing it, that if at any point this morning you think that you're standing up too much, or you're standing up and sitting down too much, then just feel free to remain seated, because some people in our congregation are more comfortable that way, and we'd rather they do that than that they keel over. So let's sing together the wonderful paraphrase of Psalm 23, "The King of Love, My Shepherd Is." These are great hymns, and I hope that today, along with our sharing in prayer and in hearing from God's word, you'll allow them to really feed your soul and really nurture your spirit. Let's share together in prayer now. Let us pray. Loving Heavenly Father, you are the creator of heaven and earth. You promise to be with us each day, each moment. And this is the time that we have come to worship you and to give you our praise. We ask that you'll open our eyes to the glory of your presence. Attune our ears that we may hear your voice. Expose our minds to the challenge of your truth. And fill our lives with wonder, love, and praise. God of mercy and grace, you know everything about us. All our faults and our failings, the things that are seen by those around us, and the things that we hide. For oh, how we can be harsh at times in judging others, and yet blind to our own faults. How we can be quick to look for praise and recognition for what we do and who we are, and yet slow to acknowledge the work of others. So often we remain silent rather than speaking words of encouragement. Forgive us, Lord. And just as we hope to be forgiven, teach us also to forgive. And help us by our deeds, our words, our actions, to show love for one another. In Christ's name. For these prayers we make in the name of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, who taught us when we pray to say, Our Father. Amen. Our next hymn we sing very often because I have to say that it's one of my favourites. And being part of this congregation, as many of you have been for all the time I've been minister here, you'll know that Charles Wesley is definitely one of my favourite hymn writers. This hymn was actually chosen by two of the ladies, but we've attributed it just now to Jeanette Rafford. Written by Charles Wesley, it has not only got an amazing tune that we sing it to, but also has words that are just so sublime. Love divine, all loves excelling, joy of heaven to earth come down.
Thank you.
Don't you just love when Eric does that bit? Just before the last verse, Emerson, Lake and Palmer still live. And if you know who I'm talking about, then you must be a certain age. Well done, Eric. That was brilliant. Great. And he's now going to show you his talents by coming to the keyboard. Because in case you thought we were going to spend all of this morning in the 18th and the 19th century, not that I'm suggesting the ladies are that age, by the way, we're not. Because what was very interesting, speaking to each of the ladies as they chose a favourite hymn for us to sing this morning, was the range and the variety of hymns which they opted for. And the next one is a good example of that. Now, it almost seems in D.L. St. Andrews that every time we sing this particular song, this next one, we have a baptism. And it's often because when we have baptisms here, I always offer the family who are bringing their child for baptism an opportunity to choose a hymn during the service. And Shine, Jesus, Shine has become a real popular choice for baptisms. It's Betty Murray who has chosen for us to sing this one. And there's a lovely story lies behind this. Betty was telling me when I spoke to her about this. She said that she remembers singing this for the very first time when she went to one of the Guild rallies in Edinburgh. And she said it was amazing to hear these hundreds, probably at least 1,000 women, all stand up and sing this for what was the first time in her hearing. And a very young man stood at the front leading the praise called John Bell. Now, if any of you know John Bell, you'll know that that must have been quite a while ago because John's in his 60s now. So if he was very young then, it was a good while ago. But it's a great hymn to sing, Lord, the light of your love is shining. Shine, Jesus, shine.
Thank you.
Well, Eric, you get a wee rest now, but not for long. Just a wee bit about the Guild. I think it's important, before we present these long service certificates, to fill in some information, some background detail. The Women's Guild, as it was then, started in 1887. And it was started by the Reverend Dr. Archibald Charteris. Today, over 130 years later, there are around 23,000 members in 900 guilds across the United Kingdom. In 1997, it was renamed the Church of Scotland Guild. And the movement now invites not only women, but also men to commit their lives to Jesus Christ, enabling them to express their faith in worship, in prayer, and in action. The Guild is actually one of Scotland's largest voluntary organisations. Although women do make up the bulk of the membership, increasingly men are becoming members and taking active roles, both locally and nationally. In fact, a few years ago, when I was doing the round of speaking to guilds about the work being done by the Vine Trust in Peru at that time, I was quite conscious that although our guild doesn't have any men, quite a lot of the local guilds around here, I think I visited something like 50 to 60 guilds at that time. Quite a few of them have men. We, of course, have a men's club. That's the adverts for today, folks. The guild's motto is taken from Acts chapter 27, verse 23. Whose we are and whom we serve. It boldly declares who they belong to and why they do what they do. Some people seem to have the misdirected view that the guild is about meeting to share in devotions, listen to a speaker, and have a wee drink, a cup of tea, and share in some conversation. Well, it is about that, but it's also about other things. It's about the project side of things, for example. From 2015 to 2018, members of the Guild were encouraged to support six projects. These were street pastors, care for the family, Christian aid, feed the minds, Mission International, and Prospect Scotland, which works with adults who have learning difficulties. And overall, from 2015 to this year, the Guild raised for all six of those projects a remarkable total of almost £750,000. I think that's incredible. On top of what all of these local guilds do for their local congregations, and we know that the guild in this congregation is hugely supportive every year, prayerfully and financially, of this congregation. From 2018 onwards, the work, the worship, and the focus of the guild is under the strategy One Journey, Many Roads. And again, they've chosen six partners to work with over the next 3 years. Crossreach, which you'll know something about because it's the social care arm of the Church of Scotland. And that's a great project to be supporting, joining up the dots, enabling people of all ages to overcome loneliness and isolation. Second project, Boys Brigade Scotland. Yeah, I paused for a cheer, but it took way too long. I'll say it again, Boys Brigade Scotland. That was a wee bit better. Faith in young people, developing, challenging, supporting boys and young men. The Sailor Society, a chaplain for our ports, supporting sailors who arrive in Scottish ports to feel cared for and valued. Free to Live Trust, SEMA's project, ensuring that children of sex workers in India are cared for. You see, the guild doesn't dodge difficult situations in the world. People have this impression about it being a wee bit twee. Not at all. Not a bit of it. Malawi Fruits, growing the future, encouraging young farmers in Malawi to develop sustainable farming. And the World Mission Council project, which empowers teenage mothers in Zambia to gain education and training. And actually, the lady who is involved with that in Zambia was here in our hall. I was here at the meeting just during the week. And not only did she speak, but she sang beautifully. I was sitting and the tears were streaming down my cheeks because she was just, it was so worshipful. It was so beautiful. So these are the six projects that are going to be supported over the course of the next 3 years. So if you wondered a wee bit about what the guild does, or you were even thinking about joining them, then that gives you a bit of background. Today we're presenting long service certificates, some for 30 plus, 40 plus, and 50 plus years of dedicated service to and through the guild. In total, these 9 women have offered almost, wait for it, 400 years of dedicated service. And they're looking absolutely great on it, they really are. And we want to give thanks to God for them, but not only for them, for those that have not quite made it to the 30-year mark, but who equally give great service to and through the Guild. The Church of Scotland Guild is being used in a mighty way by God to build Christ's kingdom in the British Isles, but also around the world. If you want to know what some of the ladies who are about to come up and receive their certificates looked like 50 years ago, then the picture on the screen was of the concert party for the young wives group, young women's group, all that time ago. And there's actually a couple of folk in the choir today who are in that 40. Now, as I read out the names of the 9 folk to get their certificates, I'm going to ask them to come up and join me at the front. We'll get a picture at the end, ladies, after the benediction, okay? So that we don't have you standing here for too long. But if you'd like to come up and join me, that's Margaret Anderson, Eleanor Crow, Margaret Mackay, Betty Murray, Jean Patterson, Jeanette Refford, Margaret Walker, Eleanor Weir, and Chris Wilson. Up you come. We'll give you your certificates. Oh my goodness, look at this. Up you come, up you come. I need to put my specs on to do this. You're going the long way, Betty. No.
Yeah, well, could you just give me it down?
I'm not giving you a carry code.
Oh, no.
You want to get around that way? Okay. She's off like a hair out of trap now. Look at that. Hey? Up you come, Jeanette. Right, Margaret. Okay, Margaret. There we go. Right, Chrissy. I see Susan's helping you and not her mummy.
She's got other help.
I was thinking, looking at you two, you weren't old enough to receive a long service certificate, but there you go.
No.
You're not. Over you come. Come on, Betty. There you go. You go and stand beside Jeanette. In you go. Over you come over the other side as well. Ladies, there's plenty of room. Just go in front of that lectern. You come round this side. Jean, how would you like to shift across a wee bit in front of that lectern so they can see you all? If you go across there, then Eleanor will get in between you. There you go. And there's Eleanor at the back as well. Right, now there's a lot of these, so you'll forgive me for only bringing a few at a time. We want to say thank you to you, and this is not me saying thank you, this is the Church of Scotland saying thank you because these certificates are all signed, and I understand they're all personally signed. I thought there was a stamp, but apparently the moderator of the General Assembly actually sits and signs all of these individually. My goodness, she must have had a sore hand at the end of that day. By Susan Brown, the Right Reverend Susan Brown. So we'll start with, I'm doing this alphabetically, by the way, do you notice, so that I no get any favourites. We present these with grateful thanks and appreciation of dedicated service. So, Margaret Anderson, a wee round of applause. And Eleanor Crowe. And Margaret Mackay. And then, wow, this gives you your Sunday name, Betty. It says Elizabeth Murray on here. Jean Patterson, when I was growing up as a wee boy in Law Village, did you ever think I'd be presenting you a long service certificate? No, you did not, did you? Jean Patterson. Jeanette Refford. Thank you, Dave. Margaret Walker. I think it's your hymn coming up next. Eleanor Weir. And last, but certainly not least, Christina. Chrissy Wilson. Let's just say a prayer of thanks, shall we? Father, we give you thanks for these ladies and for the others in our guild and in guilds across this country who serve you and who raise enormous amounts of funds to make good things happen for your kingdom and for your glory. Bless them on this special day, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. Right, now, let's get you to return to your seats, shall we? Okie dokie. Up you come, and we'll get a photo later on, I promise. The Stick Brigade. There you go. Margaret? Absolutely, absolutely. Okie dokie, Margaret. Thank you, Mary. Right, Chris. That's you, Margaret. Okay. Okay. Yes. The next hymn we're going to sing was chosen by Margaret Walker. And when I asked Margaret for a choice of hymn, she said, I know the very one because this was my mother's favourite. And actually, it's a Salvation Army hymn. That's the background to that. It's a lovely hymn. When we walk with the Lord in the light of his word, trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus. Thank you. Now, our scripture reading this morning is going to be brought to us by Mary McKenzie, who is presently the president in our branch of the Guild. And it's from 1 Corinthians chapter 13. I'm sure it's a passage you'll recognize, but not from the usual version that we would use on a Sunday, but from the Message. I think it gives it a new edge. Mary and I were talking about this just before the service began.
The way of love. If I speak with human elegance and angelic ecstasy, but don't love, I'm nothing but the creaking of a rusty gate. If I speak God's word with power, revealing all his mysteries and making everything plain as day, and if I have faith that says to a mountain, jump, and it jumps, and I don't love, I'm nothing. If I give everything I own to the poor, and even go to the stake to be burnt as a martyr, but I don't love, I've gotten nowhere. So no matter what I say, what I believe, and what I do, I'm bankrupt without love. Love never gives up. Love cares more for others than this for self. Love doesn't want what it doesn't have. Love doesn't strut, doesn't have a swelled head, doesn't force itself on others, isn't always me first, doesn't fly off the handle, doesn't keep scores of the sins of others, doesn't revel when others grovel, takes pleasure in the flowering of truth, puts up with anything, trusts God always, always looks for the best, never looks back, but keeps going to the end. Love never dies. Inspired speech will be over someday. Praying in tongues will end. Understanding will reach its limit. We know only a portion of the truth, and what we say about God is always incomplete. But when that complete arrives, our incompleteness will be cancelled. When I was an infant at my mother's breast, I gurgled and cooed like any infant. When I grew up, I left those infant ways for good. We don't yet see things clearly. We're squinting in a fog, peering through a mist. But it won't be long before the weather clears and the sun shines bright. We'll see it all then. See it always as clearly as God sees us, knowing him directly, just as he knows us all. But for right now, until that completeness, we have three things to do to lead us towards that consummation. Trust steadily in God, hope unreservingly, love extravagantly, and the best of these is love. Amen.
Amen indeed. Amen indeed. I'm bankrupt without love. What a great and direct way of describing it. And we're going to sing about love in our next hymn, which is chosen by Margaret Anderson. Now, actually, this is a very appropriate one for Margaret to have chosen. She was the other one who'd chosen Love Divine, All Loves Excelling, but deferred to Jeanette Refford and gave that one away. But Margaret had chosen this as her second choice. And it's very appropriate for Margaret. I don't know if you know the story behind this, Margaret, or the composer, but George Matheson was quite a well-known Scottish preacher in his day in the late 19th century. And he was a really clever guy. But shortly after he completed his degree, which was at the age of 19, just before he turned 20, he was going blind. Now, isn't that remarkable, Margaret, because you have such challenges with your sight. And knowing that he was going blind, he had a girlfriend at the time, and he asked her if she would marry him. And insult was added to injury when she said to him, quite directly, I could never marry a blind man. How sad that was. And he carried that sadness with him for the rest of his life. This hymn was written around the time he was aged 40, and it was on the eve of his sister's wedding, when you can imagine he himself had hoped to be married to this young woman all these years before, and it had turned out, as I've explained. And now he was seeing his sister married, and he was happy for her, but he was sad for himself. And somehow that night before his sister was married, he found the courage and the faith to write this beautiful hymn, "O love that wilt not let me go." Because although people in this life will often let us down and disappoint us, God will not. Let's sing this great hymn together. The line in that third verse gets me every time. I trace the rainbow through the rain. Isn't that God's promise that his hope is with us at all times? Many of the great hymns that we sing were born through tragedy, and the next one was not born through tragedy, but certainly the person who penned it has gone through quite a bit of tragedy in recent times. Stuart Townend is actually the person who penned two of the hymns that we're going to sing today. The next one was chosen by Eleanor Crowe, and it was actually one of a couple of hymns that she suggested, but it was her first choice. It's a great choice because it brings us into the era of modern hymns, and in this church, then we like to blend both. In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. Stuart Townend has spoken about how he has had to rely very heavily on his faith in God in recent times. In the course of the last year or so, his brother was diagnosed with terminal cancer and then sadly passed away. And so I'm sure that he, like many of us, goes back to words of promise like these.
Thank you.
And so as we bring our offering this morning for God's work, both locally and around the world, the choir are going to sing. And actually, I requested that they sing one of the other choices that was in amongst the hymn choices from the ladies, which is "Great is Thy Faithfulness." Folks, I could have sworn that I even heard the angels joining in there for a moment. Let's pray, shall we? Heavenly Father, we lay before you our offerings of money and ask that they be used to further your kingdom here on earth. We offer the gifts and the talents you've given us, the skills we've acquired in life. We offer our whole lives in your service. Help us to forget ourselves, but never to forget you, so that all we do is done for you and for your glory. And Lord, we lay before you also our concerns and prayers for others. We pray for your church here in Scotland and throughout the world, and we ask that you will sustain and bless all who by their words and actions seek to spread the good news of Jesus to all people. At this time and on this Sunday here, we remember especially the Church of Scotland Guild, the projects they support at home and abroad. Guide and inspire all who plan for the future and encourage those who deal with day-to-day tasks which make it all possible. We pray too for all who are ill, for those who know physical pain and for those who suffer mental torment. We remember those who, because of advancing years, are frustrated with activities more curtailed than they would like. We pray for the bereaved, particularly this morning, Jerry and Paula Maguire and their families, those trying to rebuild their lives after the death of someone for whom they cared deeply. Heavenly Father, there are many who have secret sorrows and anxieties which they feel they can't share, but may all who are weary and burdened with a load of care find comfort that you know their worries and that you are with them. These prayers we bring in the name of Jesus, our Lord, our Saviour, our friend. Amen. Two more hymns to go, two good ones to finish with. Margaret Mackay says that this next hymn that we're going to sing simply speaks about the continuance and the ongoing nature and the importance of her faith. Oh Jesus, I have promised to serve you to the end.
Thank you.
Sometimes people say to me, what's your favourite hymn? It's quite difficult, isn't it? I can hardly choose my favourite version of Psalm 23, never mind my favourite hymn. We're going to have our second version of Psalm 23 this morning, and it's by Stuart Townend. And when I spoke to Jean Patterson, who I said earlier on has known me from when I was a wee boy, and she still comes to this kirk, that's amazing, isn't it? That's a work of God's grace, really, right there. Jean said straight away, well, of that new version of The Lord's My Shepherd. And I said, yeah, the Stuart Townend one, I will trust in you alone. That's it, she said. I said, Jean, that'd be a great one to finish with. Because as we go out, we go, as always, trusting that God is with us. Whatever we're facing in this life, as generations of his followers have faced so many challenges, we know that Christ is with us. So let's really raise the roof. Well, maybe not raise the roof, because that window's nearly finished, and that's really the last thing to be done in this building. So we don't want the roof having to be done. Is that right, Alec? So, yeah, you know what I mean. Metaphorically, let's raise the roof with this wonderful new version of Psalm 23. You know, folks, many hymns really spark memories, and I'll never sing that hymn again without thinking about being a BB Scotland chaplain and being a chaplain at a KG6 Young Officers Leaders Training Course at Carinvale a couple of years ago. And 35, 36 young men, aged late teens, early 20s, all standing and singing that at the top of their voices. What a moving thing that is to see young men share in that way in worship. Let's close in prayer. So go now with laughter in your eyes, a smile on your lips, a song in your heart, and merriment in your soul. Share the joy that Christ has given you today and all your days.